All right, well, let's go ahead and get started. I just want to say thank you to everyone for coming today to the Federal Reserve Bank of Atlanta's Center for Workforce and Economic Opportunities Ask Us Anything series. Today, we're going to be broadly talking about some lessons from the Great Recession and if there are things that we can learn and take forward in our response to the recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic economic crisis. We're really lucky today to have a couple of people who are going to have been longtime friends of the center, but can provide some perspective on that. And I'll say that just broadly for those of you all that are new and learning about the center, our goals are really to help connect research from across the Federal Reserve System with practice and policymakers. We really focus on thinking about how employment and training help advance and make the labor market work and help connect people to opportunities. We're particularly interested in helping to create economic mobility and resilience for low-income workers and moderate-income workers. And we want to find ways to help highlight and elevate approaches that help to do that and take that work back to the ways that we also think about the work that the Federal Reserve does. Now, today's an exciting day because we've had a few of these Ask Us Anything series, but today is the first one where we're actually going to be talking about and talking with a couple of authors from a new series that we have in our Workforce Currents publication in a series called Leading Workforce Resurgence. There, we've gone across the country and to people that we know that have been doing really important work in helping to respond and recover from the economic crisis due to the pandemic. And we're collecting that information. We hope it can be a collective resource to people as they think about responses to COVID. We're lucky in that we're getting to partner with Working Nation. Jane Oates is with us today from Working Nation, and with the Heldrich Center for Workforce Development at Rutgers University. And particularly, we've got Carl Van Horn with us today. Carl's been a longtime visiting scholar at the Atlanta Fed and has helped us really kind of stand up and think about how we do work in workforce development and connect it to the Fed's efforts. So over the next couple of months, you'll hear from practitioners, from researchers, from policymakers across the country who have been thinking about how workforce development, education, training, and employment supports help people navigate the challenging economic environment that they are in today. And so now I'm going to turn it over to Sarah just to talk a little bit about the whole Ask Us Anything series and give a little bit of a guide for today.
Thanks, Stu, and welcome, everyone. Thanks so much for joining us. We're so excited both for the Leading Workforce Resurgence series. I believe we just put a link to the paper that Jane and Carl did in the chat. So please do download that. When we send the information around on this, you'll get a link to that as well. And just a reminder for how we're setting up this conversational series. So we will have calendared topics coming out. We have a couple new ones on the horizon that we'll share with you, but we aim to every 3 to 4 weeks, we'll have a new topic that now can align with the Workforce Resurgence series. We want this to be conversational. So please do consider this a two-way road in terms of thoughts that you want to share, insights that you want to share with us, and of course, questions that we can help to answer. But we really want this to be a stand-in for what would otherwise be an in-person kind of community of practice. So we want to be able to elevate your ideas, your insights, as well as share some of our own with the group around this virtual table. So we may not have all the answers to your questions, but we want to keep this to address everything that we get through here today. So please do share all of your comments, insights, questions. Use the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen to send that through for us. But rest assured, a full recording of this presentation along with the slide deck and a complete kind of readout or digest of the Q&A will be provided to you all within a few business days after this conversation. So if we're not able to get to your question today, we will address it after the fact. So save the date. We have two new sessions on the horizon, which we're very excited about. These are both Wednesdays of their respective weeks. So Wednesday, July 8th at 2 p.m., we're going to be talking about the importance of job quality and recovery. We're excited to have both the Good Jobs Institute and the National Fund for Workforce Solutions join us on that conversation. And then in August, we'll be focusing on racial equity and the future of workforce development and how we can drive towards a truly inclusive economy and recovery. So you can register now for these sessions, and for all future sessions, just keep an eye on the events page that we have for the center. The link is included here and will be provided after the fact as well. But without any further ado, we wanted to get a little bit of insight from you to help to drive the conversation today. So, you know, with the wealth of knowledge between both Carl and Jane, it's helpful for us to get a little bit of a sense of who's on the call with us today. So I'm gonna launch a quick poll here, if you wouldn't mind taking just a second and letting us know where you're joining us from today. We know that we have a lot of folks that have registered from all over the country. So just to get a good swath is wonderful for us, but to know who's on the call with us today would be very helpful. So I'm gonna let this stay open for just another moment. And I'm gonna go ahead and end the poll and share these results here. So good representation, you know, the West and the Northwest. We try to keep these later in the afternoon to accommodate your schedules, but we appreciate you joining us here today. A lot from the Southeast, Mid-Atlantic, Midwest, Northeast, all very well represented. Thank you so much for indulging us with that. And then just one other quick question here. We want to get a good sense of what your position is that you're coming from, what perspective kind of you're bringing to the conversation today. So if you wouldn't mind just letting us know quickly what type of organization you're representing. This certainly helps us as well to understand from policy recommendations perspectives for some other true, you know, practical guidance that we can provide, what focus that you're bringing to the call. So I'm going to leave this open for just another moment and end the poll here and share the results. So lots of state government, educational institutions, business and industry, and a lot of nonprofits. I'm very excited to see some economic development organizations on the call with us today. So thank you so much for joining. That's very helpful, certainly to shape the discussion that we'll have with you all here this afternoon. But without further ado, let me turn this back over to Stu to properly introduce our esteemed guests today and longtime partners of the Fed, Jane and Carl. Stu?
Well, I'll keep these introductions relatively short and actually say that these are two people that I feel like I get to learn from a lot. And that's the most important introduction that I can give. They've been people that are generous with advice and guidance on what's happening in the world and how we can think about and really structure programs that help people get back to work and move up and be economically mobile. And so their wealth of knowledge is going to be incredibly important over the next years as we respond to everything that's happened. But I'll just say that we're joined today by Jane Oates, who's the president of Working Nation and former assistant secretary of the Department of Labor for the Employment and Training Administration. Working Nation is a nonprofit that helps people understand the future of work and responses that create economic mobility. Carl Van Horn is the founding director of the Heldrich Center for Workforce Development. He's a visiting scholar at the Atlanta Fed and has really kind of coached us and been a mentor for us for the time that I've been at the Fed in building our workforce development programming. So I'm going to turn it over to them. They teamed up and took a look back at the responses that kind of both the federal government, the Federal Reserve, and state and local governments had to the Great Recession, our most recent kind of version of economic crisis, and looked at how it was relevant to today's situation, what worked well, where there were some opportunities for improvement, and what things were just not kind of the same. Some things are very similar and some were not. And so they're going to talk a lot about that, and they've written a paper. And for those of you all that can see the link in the chat, there's a longer discussion there. But we're going to turn it over to Jane and Carl, who are going to talk about that. They'll talk for a few minutes, and as you have questions or ideas that come up, please put them in the Q&A. We have a lot of time reserved for discussion with them and you all. So I will just say that it is something where we want to have questions. And so Jane and Carl, to you all, thanks so much for joining us today.
Thanks, Stu, and welcome everyone. Thanks for joining. Jane and I flipped a coin and we decided I would start first. I want to thank Stuart and Sarah for setting this up and for this whole series. And as was emphasized before, we do want to get to your questions, but we thought we'd make just a few opening remarks. So the idea behind this paper we wrote in this conversation today is, you know, what can we learn from our experiences during the Great Recession? Jane and I were in different spots then. She was leading the federal government Employment and Training Administration response. I was chairing the Economic Development Authority in New Jersey, both of us working with then Governor John Corzine. And of course, we thought then that this was the worst thing that had ever occurred in our lifetime. You know, this was horrific. The unemployment rate was incredibly devastating. And as we crawled our way out of that, which took many, many years, and of course, not everyone recovered from that, I will speak for myself. I thought, whew, I mean, I hope I never have to do that again. Well, here we are in a situation that is worse. It is by every measure worse. Now, it is impossible for anyone to say what we're going to look like as an economy and a nation 2 years from now. But it's not too early to try to figure out what did we learn from the Great Recession response that will help us get back to a better economic and equitable position this time around. And I think we did learn some lessons. One of the things that we saw in the beginning of both of these periods was strong bipartisan support for a major federal government response. But in the case of the Great Recession, that fell apart within a couple of years. And Republicans and Democrats no longer agreed on the way forward. In this response, we've seen a significant bipartisan response from the federal government at the beginning. And now we're in a pause and we don't know what's gonna happen. But clearly, again, speaking for myself, there's a lot more that needs to be done. So one of the things the article does really is summarize that quickly about what has happened so far and also what we think might happen next, what should happen next if we're going to address what we call some of the unfinished business that really was never completed in the recovery from the last recession. And in particular, many vulnerable populations, minorities, low-income, low-skilled workers not only did they not recover, but they didn't advance in their careers. And this time around, obviously, we need to focus again with all our efforts on making sure that we don't have a repeat of that story. We also need to make sure that we don't take our foot off the pedal, so to speak, too quickly and begin declaring victory. And to some extent, that is what happened the last time around. And we need to make sure it doesn't happen this time, because as I said, it is worse. And on top of that, we have, obviously, a major health crisis coinciding with the economic crisis and causing the economic crisis. So those are just a few opening remarks. Toss it to Jane for whatever she'd like to add to what I have to say. Jane?
Well, first of all, Carl, I have to tell everybody that's with us today what a great partner you have been from the beginning to me, because when I first went to New Jersey under Governor Corzine to do higher education, you were one of my first visitors, and you've been family since then. So this was great. And again, echo your thanks to both Stuart and Sarah. And I would add there, just to the bank, the Federal Reserve Bank in general, they have been so out front creating new tools for us to work with as we try to figure out what we're going to do to create a more inclusive new normal. So I would go back and say, you know, some of the tangible things that we learned at the federal level coming out of the Great Recession was how great the career staff were. I mean, political people come and go. Those career staff at ETA, world class. And the only people who came close to them were the people who did the UI work in the states. So my one ray of hope is a lot of those people, both at the federal level and state level, are still working. And thank God for that, because they'll help us figure this out if, and the big if is, if leadership listens to them. And I think that's the one thing we need to make sure we're all doing our best to inform leaders in both parties, that the people who really know how to do this are the people doing it at the state and federal level, the career people. So what did they warn us? What did they warn us about? You know, and what did we come out with? Number one, we talked about partnerships. Everything that came out during the Great Recession and for a long time after was about the critical importance of partnerships, public-private partnerships, looking to business to help us figure out and really refine the demand signals, because we didn't know then and we all know we don't know now. Nobody can predict anything right now. So those partnerships have never been more important. They should include business and education and nonprofits and government where possible. The second thing we learned was really to look forward, to not just go back to training people for where they were laid off, but training them for in-demand jobs in what was then the new economy. And that leads us right to where we are now. We know that coming out of 08 and 09, that in the 10 years that followed, over half, I think the percent, and you guys are better with numbers than I am, is about 52 or 53% of the new jobs that were created did not exist. Those titles didn't exist before the recession. I think we would all predict that we're going to see a lot of that coming out of this crisis. We're going to have new jobs being developed, not only jobs that are growing like contact tracers, but new titles that didn't exist before or we weren't aware of before. So I hope that we really follow that lead and not just train people on how to do what they already did better, but look at real in-demand opportunities and train them moving forward. And lastly, I would say one of the things we didn't do enough of in coming out of the Great Recession, because we were up to our ears in problems just like everybody is now, we didn't concentrate as much as we should have on job quality. We got people the first available job to get them back. And I love a term that I heard Matt Siegelman use a few weeks ago called lifeboat jobs. We should really understand some people need to get back to work and they need to do anything that will help them pay the bills and respect that. But we should also work with those people to have a longer term plan to get them off the lifeboat, learn the skills they acquired in those lifeboat jobs, and take them and kind of move them into a career path that's safer for them and their family in the future. So with that, do we have questions, Stuart, or can Carl and I ask each other questions?
Yeah, we have plenty of questions.
Okay.
So thanks so much for the frame. That was fantastic, and definitely underpins all of the guidance that's in the paper. So we encourage folks to take a look at that. But in the paper, you do come to some policy recommendations: strengthening education and training programs, creating public service jobs, meeting mental health needs, expanding broadband access, and assisting older workers, the long-term unemployed, as well as the recent high school and college graduates. So there's definitely some good guidance in there. And the first question that we got was, what are the lessons learned about what we should not do? You know, in particular, there were some strategies that, you know, came out of the Great Recession that reinforced income equality and racial inequities that we should avoid. So if you could offer any guidance on what we learned that did not produce the results that we had hoped to see at the Great Recession, that we can keep top of mind moving into to this recovery.
I'll just take a quick stab at that. And it's also in Jane's area of expertise. And that is, we have continued in this country to expand access to higher education, but not enough about completion of higher education. So there are millions and millions of Americans who have some college but no credential. And those folks tend to be individuals who have other factors that interfere with their ability to finish. It's not because they have no one, that they don't have the ability, but as I like to say, life happens to them. You know, they have a child or a sick relative they have to take care of, or they don't have a car so they can't get to campus and they don't finish. So there were some initial efforts in the Obama administration to address this and at the state level, but I don't think they've been significant enough. So there's just one example where the inequality continues if you don't help those people get to the finish line of having a credential that is marketable and helps them have upward mobility.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more, Carl. I mean, I think one of the things that if I had a magic wand and could go backward, I would have figured out a way to get Congress to let us treat every dislocated worker like we treated a trade adjustment assistant worker. You know, we could stay with them for 18 months. They could go in longer training. We paid for things like their equipment when they got on a job, you know, whether that was on a construction job to kind of get them the utility belt and the boots they needed, or whether it was a tech job, buying them a real computer that they could use at home. I think that inability to stay with workers, the way that we have forced the workforce development system to place people quickly so that they can get credit for it, you know, in such a short amount of time is a mistake. And we should really look at how we go back to enable them to stay with people as they transition to a new job, to give them the support, especially if it's a sector they don't have experience in, to give them somebody, that job coach, that navigator, to come back to and say, I don't quite know how to handle this. Could you help me? I think that would make a huge difference in retention in the workforce. And of course, I ditto everything that Carl said about our ridiculous over-retention on access without looking at retention and completion. So I think anything we can do along those lines as we're coming out of this would be a great benefit for the rest of time.
So we've got a question now about unemployment insurance. Jane, you had a lot of experience with that system, and this is really a question for both of you all. Is there, so that the CARES Act has fundamentally changed, at least temporarily, the way that the unemployment insurance and compensation system is running across the country, and that there are people that have access to unemployment compensation that never did before. Through the CARES Act, gig workers and workers that were part-time or didn't have enough tenure. The question that we have is there any chance that the unemployment system will be overhauled to better reflect the 21st century workplace, to incorporate gig workers and workers with non-traditional employment arrangements? And if you think that there is a chance that that happens, what are some principles that that policymakers should consider in a new system?
So I think, Carl, I'll go first on this one. I think in the short term, the best we can hope for is the continuation after July 31st of those benefits for gig workers and the folks that are only covered under the emergency provisions of the CARE Act. I hope when cooler heads prevail in a year when there's not a presidential election, in a bipartisan way, in a bicameral way, Congress can really look and see, as the economy has shifted, we need to make these changes to the unemployment insurance system permanent. And we need to have the help of lots of researchers telling us what were the lessons we learned during this time, this crisis time, and what are the things that should be incorporated into a permanent change.
Yeah, I agree. And I think the only thing I'd add to that is that, I mean, this is one of those boring but extremely important topics, and that is we need to invest in the technology of our unemployment insurance systems around the country.
Amen.
You know, they are, you know, please be sympathetic with the folks that are manning the phones or personing the phones, I should say, working their tails off to try to meet this unprecedented demand. In many states, the applications for insurance went up 1,000% within a week. Okay, so this crashed many of these computer systems and crushed the frontline workers who were trying to do that remotely because they couldn't come into their offices to do the work. So, by the way, this is not a problem we didn't know about, and it never happens because it's expensive to do it. And then we have another crisis and we say, oops, we should have done it 10 years ago. So that's one thing, and also give the support to those frontline workers to help them have the technology. And by the way, it also will help us avoid, as Jane and I pointed out, the fraudulent activities now going on that have diverted billions of dollars into somebody's account in somewhere, right? An offshore, fraud scheme, because the technology system's unsecure. So it's that's one of the things. And obviously, in addition to addressing the types of varied work that people have today, it is not all I work, I have a temporary layoff, and I come back. After all, this was designed in 1935. And we're in the 21st
century. Before we were born.
Even before I was born. And so we have to address these. And I hope we will, because it's that infrastructure is very important in good times and bad, because obviously people do lose their jobs all the time, not as many as now, but there are folks who need help.
Carl, that's such a good point, because anybody that's on the call here knows that people cross state lines to work. There's all kinds of people who are working remotely for an employer, you know, on the West Coast, and they live on the East Coast. There's so many complications in these UI applications now, and most of them are programming with some iteration of COBOL. I mean, that's insane. There's nothing wrong with that. I don't know how to do it. I'm glad somebody does. But you think about that. I mean, it doesn't have the interoperability capabilities that more modern technology does, more the software packages. So we need, you are so right. We need to invest in that now so we don't wait for the next crisis to sit around and complain about it.
Great. Thank you so much for those comments. And something that you brought up earlier in the conversation, Jane, the lifeboat skills concept in terms of thinking about how to get back into a job or to get onto a longer term career pathway. So there's a handful of questions about that, which connects to, you know, the UI and getting them into jobs and looking at different kind of stepping stones. But if you could talk just a little bit about how you see these kind of lifeboat jobs or these lifeboat credentials connecting to longer term educational pathways. So do you feel that non-degree types of credentials, short-term certificates and certifications could be used as a bridge for folks to get initially into jobs and then connect them to the more viable credential pathways? And then kind of associated with that, but also separate from it as it relates to lifeboats, just the role of technology in kind of facilitating that. So the breakdown in technology and the unemployment system, I think, kind of teed up a little bit of that and what role we see technology playing in advancing credentials, market signaling, lifeboat skill attainment.
Wow. Okay, I'll start, Carl, and you can think so you can have a smarter answer. Look, I think, again, giving Matt Siegelman from Burning Glass the credit for thinking about this lifeboat analogy, because I think it's a terrific one. Most of us have the privilege of being able to take time to study. We did in the past, and we do now if we have to. We have to remember that most people don't have that privilege. They have kids, they have bills, they have to get back to work. And for many of them equally, work is such a part of who they are that dignity of work means they can't sit home and study online, or they can't go to a campus. They want to go to work. So I respect that, and whatever the reasons are. So what's the quickest way we can get them back into a job? Hence the lifeboat analogy. But where the technology really comes in, Sarah, is how do we better crosswalk both the skills that they had before they jumped on the lifeboat job, plus the skills that they're learning in that lifeboat job, to really customize a path for them on what they need to do in addition to that to get to their aspirational job. You know, during the Great Recession, career folks at ETA developed My Next Move, My Skills, My Future, My Next Move for Veterans, really wonderful tools in 2009, and they did it quickly, and it was really a way for you to look at what you were good at and what you liked and what skills you had and what jobs required those skills and had those opportunities for you to pursue behavior that you liked. You know, do you like being with people or do you like sitting in front of a screen alone? But boy, the world has just transformed completely since 2009, and many technologies have taken that idea and really moved it along so much better. I would point out again, the Burning Glass people did something, I think, with Citi called Worthy, Worthy with an I, that kind of looks at this in a much more skills-based and looking at jobs in that skills-based frame. I would encourage people to take a look at it. And their MC has done some wonderful work on this. I think there's lots of stuff going on out there that people should look at, because what you have to decide is what's the technology that you're most comfortable with as a provider, a navigator, a coach, and then what technology best suits the client that you're serving, because it's not a one size fits all, both in terms of complexity and in terms of vocabulary, and quite frankly, in terms of the jobs they're discussing. They may not fit your geographic area, but I think there's so many tools out there that people should really be looking at to make themselves kind of supercharged in order to make these transitions with folks.
If I could just add a couple points, I agree with Jane. I think that the other point I'd make here is that quality of the education and training is extremely important. One of the lessons from the Great Recession is actually there was a lot of what I would call overconsumption of not very good training, right? Because people are desperate to move up and ambitious, and often they grab not a lifeboat, but maybe it's a life raft that sinks. You know, they get the wrong credential. And then what they've got is a worthless credential, which they spend a lot of time on, and then it doesn't actually relate to a job. So what that means is we need to have referees in the process, and that is trusted sources, often government agencies who are investing their resources in these. We need to rely upon them to be the referees to say, hey, this delivers a good return on investment, this program, that one doesn't. If it doesn't, we're not going to give it any money. And also give full transparency to individuals and make sure it gets to them, so that when they're thinking about investing their time, and maybe saw a third party paying for it, but it's their time, that at the end of the day, they have a pretty good chance it's going to pay off. And I think that's something we have a better capacity to do now than we did before. There's a lot more information out there. And so I think that's another issue, which I hope we don't repeat that same mistake of people getting a lot of essentially worthless credentials that don't relate to what a business is interested in or a nonprofit, and hence they're further put back in a sense, maybe even go into debt and not have something to show for it.
Yeah, I think, Carl, that's so good. I want to stop here for a second because I want to play with you for a minute on something. You and I both feel very strongly about labor market information. Speaking for both of us, we don't think there should be any training that's not looking at current labor market information, future predictions. You know, that whole idea of, you know, you don't train somebody just because you have a good training program that you created in 1950. You know, that whole thing has, those programs, all of our programs for training have to be re-examined regularly to make sure they're still meeting the needs of businesses and getting people into good jobs. But right now, I have never seen such confusion in the job signaling, what the employers are signaling. I mean, you hear people say, well, I worked in retail, so I guess I'm done. I mean, I don't believe that retail is finished. I believe that retail is going through a transformation, and we have to be ready for that. I don't believe that, you know, dine-in restaurants are finished. You know, I think we're going to figure out ways to adapt and go on. But people that have been furloughed and not called back yet from those sectors and others are really getting mixed signals. They read a crazy article that says, you know, manufacturing is dead. That's what we saw in the last recession, right? Notice it didn't die, but it certainly moved from manufacturing to advanced manufacturing. So what do you think about, what advice could we give people about watching those signals and not being discouraged?
Well, I think what I would say is that in most states, I think labor departments provide very good quality labor market information, which I would use instead of the USA Today article for making your decision. I think it's, I go back to the essential nature of high quality government services. And that's really what most of our labor market information units provide. I think the difference is that we also have other players, if you will, private for profit players in the space, many of them offering their services to government agencies. But it's sorting out the difference between the purveyor of the training versus the person who is your independent advice. And that's the difference. And certainly if an employer says, if you have to have a master mechanic certificate to work in this auto dealership or whatever it is, then obviously that's pretty simple. That's the one you want to get. But in other cases, you know, it could be an employer provided training, but in other cases you'll have, and it will happen this time too, a lot of institutions, higher education, others, for-profits, bandits, marketing training programs with some, you know, pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. And I simply say that let's make sure that the quality information is coming from our labor market people. Again, they can't predict everything, but they can tell us what are the credentials people are looking for right now. If you look at most of the jobs that were posted in the first month after the closing down of the country, it was in delivery. You know, thousands and thousands of Instacart and all the other services, Amazon and so on. And those jobs, you know, they're paying more than they used to before. And they're even waiving requirements for a commercial driver's license. So in many cases, those are great lifeboat jobs because people could, although I must say they're also putting themselves at somewhat more risk than other people, but that won't last that way forever. There will be other jobs opening up, and there are jobs opening up which require more education and training and have the ability to transfer the skills that you've had in another place to that new opportunity.
So I want to jump in with a couple questions that actually point back to the Great Recession that we've gotten. Particularly around labor force participation and its role as a really ascendant statistic that governors began to kind of track very heavily during the Great Recession because of declines in participation, often because of older workers and discouraged workers. What do you think is going to happen? So the questions are a couple. One is what do you think may happen with labor force participation, and what can it tell us today, given the contours of the current crisis? And also, how do we balance engagement in the workforce between older workers and younger workers today? And how do we balance kind of the needs of all of those populations?
Well, I'll take a shot at the labor force participation issue. I mean, this is very important because if people drop out of the labor market, they're not counted in that unemployment number, right? So that's why we often say that's a misleading indicator. It's also one that lags. So you want to, right now, look at who's registering for unemployment insurance. That's the better number to look at. Going forward, as we recover, we're also going to want to look at the labor force participation. Have people left, retired early, or simply given up when in fact they need to continue working in order to have a family sustaining income and wage, right? Look, there's been lots of research on this, notwithstanding any of the myths you might hear otherwise. Americans do not want to sit home and collect benefit checks. They want to work. Right now, a very large percentage of those people on unemployment insurance are furloughed workers, and they think they're going to come back. The surveys show about 75% of them think they're going to return to work. I hope that's true, but many of them won't. So what happens to them? Do they become permanently out of the labor market? And in the last recession, what we saw as it went on and on, a lot of those workers did stay out, and the longer they stayed out, the harder it was for them to get back in. Because there was a stigma attached to them. Employers said, well, if they're out of labor market for 2 or 3 years, there must be something wrong with them. When in fact, what it was, they were just misreading the economic situation, that they thought, I can continue to be fill in the blank, whatever it was, and I'll get that job back. And as Jane said earlier, this economy is going to change again, this time very rapidly. And so what we want to do, especially with those workers who are at risk of dropping out of the labor market entirely at whatever age, we want to keep them engaged and looking how do they get themselves marketable in the new economy. And I'll stop there and let Jane add or subtract or whatever you want to do, Jane.
Never subtract. Unfortunately with this, I have more questions than answers. I mean, I'm going to watch older workers who have always had faced some discrimination, but I'm going to watch them to see, it's possible that some older workers, 55 and older is how I would define them, may take early retirement if they have a defined benefit plan. So teachers, government workers, they just may throw their hands up and say, you know, I just can't do remote learning in September. I went nuts this spring. I can't do it again. So if they have 30 years and their state contract or their local contract allows them to retire after those years, you may see them taking it. And if that happens, we should watch that talent pool so we can use it because we need them still. But it would be hard for me not to say that my first worry is younger workers. They were hit disproportionately right now. And the youngest of younger workers completely denied the opportunity in most places this summer for summer employment. And those of us who are big supporters of summer jobs for young people know that it not only puts money in their pockets for college, for books, for transportation, but it puts skills in their toolbox, real job skills that they have gotten in those summer job programs for decades. And I know cities have no choice, but not to offer those programs. Some cities are doing some remote stuff, but I would hope that when these young people go back to high school or college, and I believe they will go back to college in September, that the educational institutions are looking for ways to make sure they can get those work skills. They're looking at new ways to build in work-based learning, whether it's paid internships or whether it's just job-related activities in classes across the spectrum, because we're going to pay for this. We're going to pay for these young people not being able to get these jobs this summer, and we need to find a way to mitigate the risk of this on their longer-term workforce participation and success.
And just to add to that, we also need to worry about a resurgence of loan defaults by students that we experienced the last time around.
That's right.
And again, the longer this goes on, the less their ability to get a job to begin to pay back those loans and so on. And that's why, again, on Congress's agenda as well, in my humble opinion, they need to be thinking about how we help those students who are challenged economically, so that they don't become folks who've defaulted and unable to often get another job because they have that on their record.
Mm-hmm. Great. A couple of pieces that were batted about in that discussion that I just wanted to pull through here because it connects to the next question. I really love what you said, Jane, about the lack of these youth employment programs for these students to build skills and for the youth to be able to build those skills. I think that's a key component that connects to the ability to get older workers back into the workforce or transition them, because you're valuing the skill and not necessarily the occupation. Looking at the skills and the competencies within that experience and how it connects to the next opportunity and really looking at these market signals. Those were a couple of other questions that came through. How do we even begin to prepare folks for jobs that we don't know exist yet and we don't understand the skills that are going to be needed? So, you know, I love that you said you have to be able to live in the fray a little bit with that and work with these labor market information kind of experts and your employers to provide that effective signaling so we're not promoting education and training that doesn't necessarily result in the right type of job or the right type of career pathway. So I just wanted to pull those themes out because they've connected to a handful of other questions that we've received as well. But I want to take a moment and just kind of pull us back to what we need to do to ensure that we do have kind of an equitable and inclusive recovery. And what are some of the ways that the workforce system can go about promoting equitable pathways, equitable recovery, and whether that connects to wraparound supports for these populations and things like that. If you could talk a little bit about some kind of strategies and tactics on the racial equity and inclusion side.
Sarah, could I just go back 1 second on the point you made before we get to the next question?
Sure.
And that is, Jane and I are both huge fans of employer-based training programs and providing, you know, when necessary, especially to small businesses, some subsidies to help them afford the training of onboarding employees, right? And so this is something, again, that it's been in the toolkit for a long time. It falls in and out of favor almost as quick as the weather changes in certain parts of the country. But it really is something, again, we should double down on this time. And if we, I'll just tie it to the equitable point you made. Small minority women-owned businesses tend to be less than 10 employees. They can't afford often to train their workforce. Let's help them. Let's help them train up their onboarding their employees to make them effective in whatever field they're in. And they're in the complete range of fields in the United States, from manufacturing to tech to personal services and so on. You know, let's help those small businesses, those women minority-owned businesses who will provide economic opportunity for people in their communities.
Carl, you bring up such a good point because in 2008, 2009, ETA was always partnering. I think my people were thought that I was insecure because I was always partnering with somebody else. But the one of the odd partners that we had is with the Ex-Im Bank, the Export-Import Bank, because one of the ways that we saw building jobs was getting people, small businesses, to learn how to export. You know, so even if they only exported to one country, they could double or triple their market share. So I think that we don't want to ever lose track of the business. But I do want to go back, Sarah, to your question about equity. And this is a hard one, right? I mean, because I don't know who to attribute this quote to, but somebody said this to me a long time ago, and I thank her or him. But they talked to me about the bigotry of low expectations. And it's such a meaningful phrase that sticks with me every day. And how do I mean that? If somebody was laid off from a job at a local restaurant, our first inclination is to show them jobs at another restaurant at the same pay they got when they worked before. And instead, if we could start looking at what's their skill set and where could that skill set be utilized for a higher salary. And you're right, we don't know about what jobs are going to be there, but we do know certain things. Digital literacy is critical. Digital is everywhere. When Carl talked about the growth in jobs and delivery service, you know, the big heading for that is e-commerce. Well, you can't work in e-commerce if you don't know how to use the technology. So we should make sure that everybody who passes through our door could pass whatever we gave as a digital fitness assessment, a digital literacy fluency test. We, you know, obviously everybody has a smartphone and knows how to get whatever, Uber, food, whatever you want, but do they know how to do that related to a job? And we should figure out how to train them to do that so they could put it on their resume and maybe go from what they did before with these new digital literacy skills and move into some a higher paying job. I think we need to look carefully at growing fields like cybersecurity. Too few community colleges and too few nonprofits are training people to enter that field. And lastly, I would say data analytics. You know, there are so few programs below the baccalaureate level for data analytics. And yet there are lots of good jobs that pay family sustaining wages that could also open that world of data analytics to you. So you could help, you could get help from your employer to get your associates or your baccalaureate or your master's degree in that topic if it was a field that really held interest for you.
Yeah, those are great points. I agree with Jane, and I think that it relates to another point that we highlighted in our article about the continuing digital divide in this country. As Jane said, the data show that most people, regardless of income, have some sort of smartphone. That does not make you capable of being a remote worker. Have to have your own device. You have to have, it has to have broadband high-speed broadband access, excuse me. And this is becoming, you know, the new form of discrimination. If you don't have that in your home, you're being left out of the economy. So and this is something which is a state and federal level issue. I've argued that this is a lifeline service in the same way we talked about telephones 50 years ago. You have to have broadband access because that's an essential life support. And that's another, and by the way, it's not that expensive to do it. The cables and wires are all over the country in most cases. It's a particular problem in rural parts of this country, but it's also, there are also digital deserts in some of the largest urban cities. I'm proud to say as a New Jerseyan that 95% of New Jerseyans have at least the wire into their apartment or home. But that, you have to go that last 50 feet. So I'll stop there.
So we've got one more question that we want to take, and there's been so many. We will work to answer the ones that we haven't been able to get to today, unless everyone's ready to extend by about 2 hours. We could keep going. But a question came in that we have in common, that we have not done a lot of rethinking of employment and income support. So not only unemployment insurance, but broadly employment and income support. And it's something that is needs some serious rethinking, and wanted to see if you all had thoughts on that.
Well, I'll just make a quick comment. It's interesting that the Congress passed a income support of $1,200, I think it was, for every family earning less than $100,000 a year. No questions asked. That the idea that if you had proposed that 9 months ago, you would have said, oh yeah, that's interesting. You know, that's not gonna happen. So there's a toe in the water, but it will take a much, much more than that. We have bits and pieces in our social safety net to try to address that. It's a mess. It's very hard for people to figure out what benefits are they eligible for. Is this a disincentive or incentive for taking a job? So, you know, this is a huge long-term project, but I think we can do things in the interim just to give people more transparency about what they can, in fact, benefit from now, even in the patchwork confusing system that we have.
Well, and I just think it's crazy that we live in the best country in the world and we're so stupid about certain things. I can work with a woman with three children to get her a better paying job, but oops, if she makes a dollar over, she loses her food stamps, her WIC, her childcare support, and she can no longer go to work. I mean, it's crazy. We should incentivize people making more money, earning more, learning more, but we should recognize that they're not going to make the jump from a minimum wage job, regardless of what that is in your local area, to family sustaining wages in one quick leap. They're going to need those support systems, the subsidies that they got, to keep them able to make that progress. First we saw it with the disability community when so many people with serious disabilities couldn't take that job because they'd lose their Medicaid. Isn't that insanity? I mean, we need to examine these principles, get brave elected officials who are willing to take them on and change them. Because I think this is the time, if we waste this crisis, this nightmare, the loss of already over 117,000 Americans, if we waste this and don't really take care of the things, we rip the Band-Aid off. We've seen all the ugliness that has existed. We need to fix it.
Well, thank you so much. That were powerful words, Jane, and I think that gives us a lot to think about here. And Carl, I didn't want to cut you off if you had something else to add.
I just gave an amen to Jane's statement.
Absolutely.
We're so used to this. Amen, Carl.
Well, rest assured, you have a lot of support on the call to think critically about what the system can do, how we can push on these conversations at the federal, state, and local levels. And again, as Stuart said, we could be on this call for 4 more hours and still have a ton of other questions that we likely still would not be able to get to. So we really appreciate all of your comments here today. And I would say, if you can, just if there's anything that we can leave to the folks on the phone here, if there's one final kind of thought that you want to put in their heads that you think has been overlooked in kind of the static of the chaos that this pandemic has been, what might that be?
Well, I would just like one point, and that is I think that we need to commit that the recovery from this terrible crisis is not a recovery to the way things were before, but to a better economic situation for all Americans, free of racism and economic opportunity for everyone. And I think that's, to me, the guiding light, not to go back to what we had before, but to rethink the kind of country we want to have for everybody.
Amen to that, Carl. And the only thing I would add to that is you should use the Federal Reserve Bank's tools like crazy. Their new tool on unemployment is superior. And watch for the articles. I think you're going to love the Resurgence series. And whether you love it or hate it, give us your feedback because we're really all invested in it. The three musketeers here. Or four, Sarah.
Great. Well, thanks
Thank
again
you,
so
everyone.
Much. Yeah. And I just also want to highlight too, we can put in the chat and certainly follow up because the benefits cliff challenge is something that the Federal Reserve in Atlanta has been looking very critically at. And we have a handful of resources that are out there and more to come in the future. I know some other states, we got a comment from Kentucky, has built their own kind of cliff tool to understand where those drops and other support services are. So we agree that's such a critical flaw, essentially, in the way that the system has been set up. So we're looking at that too. But with 1 minute left, again, I can't thank Jane and Carl enough for joining us in the conversation. We have our future sessions coming up in July and August. We'll send all of that detail out to you so you can register. But Stu, I'll hand it over to you to close us out.
Yeah, I don't have a lot more to add other than just one more thank you to Jane and Carl for joining us today. Be on the lookout in about a week and a half for a synopsis. We're going to answer questions that we weren't able to get to today. I lost count a little while ago, but you guys are an incredibly engaged audience. We've gotten over 35 pieces of feedback, questions, ideas, things that we can look at. And it's the work that you all do that keeps us up and helps us do things. So we're going to take that. We're going to answer everything that we can. We're going to take the feedback that we got and help us set what we work on in the future. So thank you all. And thank you all for the work that you do.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a great afternoon, everyone.
Thanks, guys.
Bye, everyone.